copied who, but well, that's how it happened. And then we, 2019 is the second year that Swachhta Awards were given in Puducherry, and the whole concept of bringing in corporate responsibility, when we started in 2018, it came with a lot of, when you start something new, it always comes with a lot of doubts, haves, buts. But the thing with ma'am is she's so clear. She says, no, it's okay. We are doing something for the people. So it's okay to get the phone and call and say that you need to do this. Of course, now with Government of India saying CSR, so much percentage of your profit goes for CSR. That is the Government of India stand today. It's a policy. But in 2018, it was very flimsy. Whether the corporate money had to be taken into the government and then we had to spend it, or we could just be a facilitator. So in 2018, when Raj Nivas started doing this, Madam was very clear that we are not going to ask money and get money involved. We just say this is the need and this is the provider. You just connect the need and the provider. Like if a company is doing CSR, this is the work to be done. You just connect them. We have nothing to touch with the money. And when we did that, it came under a lot of things like, is this the right way to do? Is this the wrong way to do? Well, we just did that because that was the best way to do and that was the most transparent way to do. And today in 2019, we have the Ministry of Commerce headed by Dr. Sitaraman, who says that's exactly the way to do things. So what we did in 2018 with a lot of conviction, that was the only thing. It wasn't a policy decision. It was just a conviction that this is how it was to be done. And now Ministry of Commerce has brought in that CSR when you are doing in the government, you could just be a facilitator. You could connect the needs and you could connect the providers. That's exactly what Raj Nivas under Dr. Kiran Bedi has been trying to be. A facilitator to connect, whether it is a grievance, whether it is a need, whether it is a deprived person who needs some assistance. All throughout, wherever Raj Nivas is an open Nivas today, on various platforms, whether it's receiving visitors and connecting you to Dr. Bedi and to be further inspired, or we have something called the open house at 5 o'clock, Mondays to Wednesdays, 5 to 7, the Raj Nivas is open for anyone, just anyone. You don't need an appointment. You can just walk in and you come in and you meet the governor herself. She's there with her team, her officers, and then you have a group of Dalit, you have a women counselor, because these are major issues which come up, domestic abuse, or people having land grabbing, you need the local dalit. So we have a cell which functions between 5 to 7 years, they meet ma'am. And then she directs that whomever they have to meet, in case it can be resolved internally, or it can be resolved sometimes on a phone from her office to the concerned person, or we have something called a pick slip. So she just writes them to the concerned officer, like, collector please examine, or director so and so please examine, or do it. But the power that slip gives to that person who has a grievance. You know, it's not very easy for somebody to go and get an appointment to the government office. But when you're going with a pink slip like this, addressed, signed by the governor, and when the governor herself is having open house Mondays to Wednesdays, most officials are following it. We have the DGP who is having something in Tamil, I forget the name, Makkal Sandhi. So he also has had the same thing. So it has become inspired by her, most officers have this open house, and when you go with the slip and you meet the concerned officers, I'm sure, you know, problems get resolved. Thank you. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Shared memories. So all of you live in Chennai?
Yes.
So
there are.
Sorry? And the two gentlemen?
They are from Chennai, from the latest chapter. So they are
Why advisors? Why not co-option? Why not co-option? It's very good to be inclusive. You listen to them, they listen to you, and the best of it comes out. Right?
Yes.
As it's been said on the issue of crimes against women, I've been saying the problem is not with girls, the problem is not with the women, the problem is with the men. It's the boys who are hurting the girls, not the girls hurting the boys. So why are you holding back the girls? Work with the boys. Ask them, why are you hurting the girls? Why are you disrespecting the girls? So the problem here is that when they grow up, they don't grow up inclusively. And it's the answer to everything is inclusive code, where we listen to learn, when we learn to listen to each other and value everybody's presence and dignity. So the problem I've always been saying is not with the girls. It's with the boys, the way we nurture them. Because we separate them. Right from the beginning at home, we separate them. That you are so and so, you are so and so. This is what you meant for, this is what you meant for. So that's, and then, mommy, this is what mommy's meant for, this is what daddy's meant for. So then they start isolating the way mommy does. Oh, daddy earns, brings so much, mommy only spends. Right? So that's what the absence is. About not inclusive society. So therefore, incorporate even the women's group. Have a day with the men and listen to them. They must listen to you too. Then you'll have a healthier society. You don't have two men. They and us. It's us. It's not we and we. It's we. Not you and I. It's we. But it's good to be inclusive too, where you share your concerns. But it's important to be in that way, in more interactive. Like for instance, if I would have my day, I'll say, boys, an order for the boys, be the home by 10 o'clock. Leave the road for girls. Let them have fun. Let them feel a sense of freedom and a sense of security. Why can't we have? Can you imagine an order coming by, all boys, return home by 10?
It would be so true. Possible landing.
Sorry?
Possible.
That's the way. I think boys must learn to come and respect and care for the parents as well. That they also, and they must also join the dinner, you know? While girls come back home for dinner. What about boys? No, I'll have my friends, but girls also have friends. If you don't want the sisters to be away, then they want the brothers to be back. So I'm more for inclusiveness. But yes, we need to hear each other as smaller groups. But in the end, the more together we are, the better. It just came because of the two pillars. Everybody should be a pillar in their own way.
Yes.
So, what can I tell? What can I share?
Anything, ma'am. Whatever you think.
I've shared one concept. Why don't you apply this with your boys at home?
Yes.
Try doing that in
Singapore.
Yes.
Sure.
But that should begin not when they are already 20.
20, yes.
You should begin with them when they are 5. When they are 5, 4. And so is it with the girls. The rule is for all. Everybody home for dinner, finished. The rule is for all. Then it makes a difference. And also appreciating what mommy and daddy do. My mommy does this for me. If my mommy wouldn't do this for me, I wouldn't be able to do so much. And daddy does so much for me, I wouldn't be able to do so much. And that is when that genuine respect in society. Because without that, you see, I believe the home is the nucleus of society. Every home is very important nucleus. And in the home, the leadership is with the mother and the father. The grandparents play their own role. But the real decider is the mother and the father in the room. And if every family starts taking care of itself, you'll see the whole society, the whole neighborhood will be better. The whole town would be better, the whole society would be, the whole village would be better. The whole society will have better human beings. In the end, it's all about the health of the society. It's not the physical health we're talking about, the mental and the social health. We don't work on social health, we don't work on mental health, and we let it be. They think mental health is for a psychiatrist and social health is for a social worker. Whereas it is the mental and the social health comes back to the family, which is the nucleus. And in that nucleus, two pillars is the mother and the father. One pillar weak, that much of the family is weak. My home, in fact, I think that's where my strength came from when I was growing up. My father was a remarkable tennis player. He wanted all girls play tennis, to be tennis champion.
You mean you are a tennis champion?
So, and my mother was a strong educationist, because when she was growing up, she was a very, very bright student. And her, when her parents found a very wealthy family from my in my father's family in Amritsar, they were very wealthy and they were very well known in their own the whole town. They thought they got a lovely match for my mother, and she was a brilliant student. And she told her parents, "No, mujhe padhna hai." But my grandparents said, "Nahi, bada acha ghar mila to jao." Those were the days, and she never gave up. She wanted to study further, but then the children came. And then she made sure that all four girls of us just did nothing but study. So my sports came from my mother, two pillars. So that became the pillars of my life. Is one came as education, the other came as sports. Imagine two things merging in a young girl's life at the age of 6 and 7. What more can you want? And at that time, does a girl know how is sports going to be valuable for the girl and how is education going to be valuable? Nobody knew. I just did what my parents told me. Unfortunately, we had no boys. We were all girls. And there was no competition amongst us. I'm sure my father and my mother just thought four girls need to make son around. But when there was no son around, we were very, very equal. We were just loved by them. My grandfather wasn't like that. My grandfather was a very feudal, wealthy man, but very feudal. And he would say, "Why are you sending these girls, your daughters, to the best of the most expensive school in Amritsar, which was farthest away from the city, farthest away?" And my father was on a pocket money of the grandfather. Those days, if you remember, sons used to work for their fathers, and fathers would give them a pocket money, even when married, because the kitchen was common. So you don't have to spend anything. This pocket money is for your cinema, for your club, or whatever. So my parents had a pocket money. But by the time we came, there was no money extra for my school fee. So my grandfather said, "Why are you sending your girls to such as the most expensive school in town, when the school is close by, it's free?" So my father, for the first time, then told my grandfather, saying, "You decided on my life, you will not decide on the life of my children." For the first time. He never used to speak up against his father. He was very, very, very respectful. But I remember. So see how two mainstreams coming equally. For us, it was just, there was no dichotomy, there was no confusion, there was no dilemma. And the fact was that you are growing up to make your own lives. And you need both. Tennis, not to compete to be national champions. That was not the objective. Play. Playing is very integral. Study, that's very integral. And there was just one black and white television those days, the Doordarshan. So you should only sit, all of us sit together and watch Chitrahar together. Or the serials together, that's it. Otherwise there was nothing else. Even before that television also, we had the Bush radio, the Murphy radio, where we used to listen to the radio news. That's all. Life is so simple. But it was so lovable. Everybody did get together, ate and shared everything together. That togetherness, I think, is the bedrock of every family, which is now disintegrating. I'll tell you a story where a teacher had an essay competition in the class, and the teacher said, "All of you write, what would God want you to be? Children, write an essay. What would God want you to be?" So everybody wrote their essay and a story. What would you like to be? So she brought home that chapter, all those papers, to start to correct them. And she was a class teacher, a reasonable about 7th, 8th, 9th, 8th. So in that, and while she was marking the paper, she was crying. She was crying, she was sobbing. Her husband asked her, "Why are you sobbing?" She said, "Read this paper." So she gave him the paper. And when she read the paper, when he read the paper, and he said, "Very cruel parents. The parents must be very cruel." He said, "No, it's us. It's our son." I said, "Why? What has he written?" He says, "The son has written I wish God, next in my next birth, you make me a television. Make me a television. So that everybody sits around you, everybody laughs, everybody watches, and everybody wants their own little channel, and everybody, when it's cricket, everybody laughs, everybody enjoys. And also, they all have competition, which one I want, but they all want the same television. And then my father comes, he immediately wants to watch the television. When mommy's tired, mommy wants to watch. So everybody wants a television. God, in my next birth, please make me a television. Why? Because he wanted attention. He wanted blooming. He wanted nurturance. He wanted care. He wanted recognition. He wanted a sense of wanting and belonging. So that's, I think, by and large, it's emerging in my feeling is that family is the nucleus in which you as mothers and fathers play the most important role. I can't imagine a substitute for any child. And the strengthen the mother, warmer the father, and more harmony in both, child is a beneficiary. But disharmony affects them. We don't realize it, but time is flying for children. I've seen this happen again in my police career, prison career. Whenever I talk to these youngsters, they had lost out both on parenting and teaching. Even the teacher didn't pay attention. The teacher let the child fail. In the line, this was done. He failed. So, usko fail hota hota, drop out. Nobody bothered for the child. The child, teacher never went back to school to find out what happened. So the child dropped out, and the child dropped out, and he fell into bad company, started to smoke, started to drink, started to take drugs, fell into bad company, and got him now. He needed money for those drugs, and he started with small crimes. From small crimes, he graduated to big crimes, and he landed up in jail. So this, it's not substitutive, time runs away. Yes. So any other questions, which I may not be able to. Whatever you do in your social work or whatever, stay focused. Beginning from your own home. It should start from your own home and then stretch it out. And be a support to each other. Sisterhood is very important also. Brotherhood remains, but sisterhood is very vital. If you need each other's help, be there. If I'm as a working woman traveling and my family children need care, extend help as neighbors or as friends. Sisterhood is very, very important in our current working lives. And the right kind of friendships with each other, of the boys and the girls, amongst your friends. How do you get your children together to be a healthy friendship? It's also very important bonding. Not just you all bonding, it's your children also bonding. It's very, very vital. To me, that will be contributing to a better human being. Because in my career, I've noticed in government leadership, as a secretary or a collector or as SP of a, the background of the person is very important. If the person has had a good grooming, the person is much better. But he's had a bad grooming or a sadistic grooming or not a happy grooming, or he's not happy with himself, it affects on his work. He doesn't like his work. He doesn't love his work. He looks at the clock and just leaves, or he leaves things unattended. Or he doesn't extend the extra mile for the public which is required in public service. But another person who's a product of love and care and recognition and nurturance and rewards and a lot of mentoring, he's a different person. He mentors, he loves, he cares for others as well. He's also more honest. So where did that man come from? The training is the same, the MBA is the same, the IIT is the same. Why the one person different from the other? Is the way he was groomed, the way he was groomed. So remember one thing, it's too late sometimes. Why NDA? Why do you go when you do matchmaking? Why do you want to know about the family? Why? Why do you want to know about the family? Family grooming, not background. You look at kitna aisa hai. Look at the grooming. So how has the boy or the girl been groomed? That is going to get reflected. Not how much money he has.
Exactly.
lots of activity. Very interesting story, since you talked to Mali yesterday. Two brothers returned home to their own father. And father called them to see, I sent you away, let me see, how are you returning? One had joined a very wealthy business group, and he collected a lot of wealth and valuables for his father to come and gift them. The other went into education and continued to accumulate or learn a lot of knowledge and skill. He became an educationist, he learned education, but he didn't have much money to buy. Both came back home. One person, the wealthy man, was waylaid by robbers on the way, and they took away all his money. And he went back home empty-handed. But the one who had all the knowledge and the wisdom went back with wisdom himself, because nobody could steal his knowledge and which he had acquired over the years. I think we need to tell these people, wealth is required, but to what extent? So if you have, looking only to a very dirty, rich family, if you don't look at the values that wealth may not give you health. Wealth is required for health, but excessive wealth may not give you health. On the contrary, it may bring you ill health. And you spend all the money into health recovery. And you say, I wish God, give me health, take my wealth. For societies here is how do we produce better leadership in India? How do we produce better men and women in India? It's better homes which you provide, better school which you provide, college is even great. It's a better school, it's a primary teacher, and it's a primary mother and the father. And also grandparents play a wonderful role, because they step in when the parents are not at home, and they sing the lullabies, and what they sing a story, now whether they have the time at all. So friends, that's the story.
You never feared when you were dealing with the Tihar jail convicts and all? I mean, they were all into a very different... they were totally...
The first thing you, when you wear a uniform, you get rid of fear.
What we have heard is that you literally, you know, like all those murderers and all that, that fear never came, because you know we girls have been brought up in the left hand, so you know, be away, keep away from,
because you're not in uniform.
So that uniform gave you the strength.
Uniform gives you the power, gives you the sense of responsibility, it also trains you. And you have the law on your side. You have the power to do. See, you have the power to punish. You have the power to wield a stick. Right? So you have the power. But why should you be afraid of your own power?
Like, you know, when you're dealing with such people,
that's because you're not in uniform. If you also wear a uniform, that's why girls and boys doing NCC makes all the difference. Make them wear a uniform early. Similarly, wear a sports dress early. They become stronger. So if you don't involve them into extracurricular activities when the children are small, even if they are in uniform later, they will not wield that much effectiveness, because they're still learning. But if you wear a uniform, Then from a NCC cadet and a sports person wearing a uniform, it's double. The heart is already strong.
What do you fall back on in times of stress? What is your source of bearing the stress in public life?
I read.
You read.
I read. I listen. I read. Music is another therapy which I walk. I exercise. I take a distraction and a diversion. I walk. I go for a walk. Or I listen. Or I distract. Or I read. Or I search. Or I think. Or I analyze. It's so many things at the same time. So it is like self-analysis. It's not always that you can share your anxiety with another. You don't want to transfer the anxiety to another. You're concerned. Or you're afraid of being blackmailed later. So there are all options available, but anything you're afraid of, is best is break it down into dissect it. Find the cause of this and address the cause. Do you have an answer to it or not? If you don't have an answer, go for a walk. But if you have an answer, focus on the answer and start doing bit by bit. So So it's breaking down that pahar into steps. It's very, how will I climb that? You measure it and then you know your stamina. Okay, I'll do 10 steps today. So start taking 10 steps. And suddenly by the time you're on the 50th step, you realize I've come that far. I was so afraid of it. It's so close. It's so close. So you keep moving it. So it's dissect your problem into pieces. And then analyze, what is it that I can do? What am I capable of doing? What is in my capacity to do? What is the help I need if I can get it? What is the new skill I need to learn? And focus on doing, correcting it, rather than the problem, you are now on the solution. But the sources are many. It can be a pravachan, it can be a bhaktika music, it can be a walk, it can be a family group, it can be groups like these, go and have fun. So situationally, you'll have to find your own place where you go and look for a, find an opportunity to think afresh. Completely changes your mind too. If you are sad, when you're sad, what do? If you stay alone, you keep crying. But if you go to family and a group and friends, they start cheering you, you share your grief. So sometimes it's sharing your grief. So it all varies from a situation to situation. But never get overawed by the problem. Dissect the problem, go to the root of the problem, and then ask yourself, what is it that I can do? What is it that is beyond me that I don't have to worry? I can't, forget it. I'm a failure, but I'm a fool. I must understand I can't. So why should I distress that I can't? But what can I do? What is it that other thing I can do which will give me a sense of compassion? So it's all about self-analysis and self-thinking. You must have a personal library of your own. The best of the library, the best of the music. If you have the good music, the good library, pick up that book and read. Oh my God, even one paragraph changes your thought if you hit on the right paragraph. Do your self-reading on a daily basis. You must read every day. Something you need to read every day. Find out what is it that you want to learn, which inspires you, which charges you, which reinvents you, re-energizes you. Anything, read, get into the habit of reading. Doesn't matter if you read so many pages, just sometimes one paragraph is enough. Reading that and going for a walk and mulling over it. It's empty. You want to then, you read something nice and you want to hold on to something, say, Sun, Meri Bhata Chakra, I love it. Come, share. But that's already energy for you. Good thought is finally, we are what we think. Isn't it? It's not what we do. It's what we think we do. So we are what we think. So the moment you start thinking negatively, start understanding yourself, I'm depressing myself. I'm giving a havan, ahuti to a negativity. Stop it. So that means you need to be two persons yourself. Don't you remember in old movies of Hema Malini and Nutan and others, they would talk into the mirror, maine usko ye bola ki aise tu mat kar. मैं ऐसे ही करूंगा, मैं तो माँ बाप का कहना मानूंगा, मैं कहूंगी कि नहीं तो फिर मैं क्या करूंगी, ऐसे माँ बाप का बात सुन के तो उसका तो इसे यू शी इज टॉकिंग टू ईच अदर, जस्ट टॉक टू ईच अदर, गो टू द मिरर एंड टॉक, गो टू द मिरर एंड टॉक, शी वुड टॉक अबाउट द बॉयफ्रेंड गर्लफ्रेंड प्रॉब्लम्स. एक्चुअली वो टॉप उसने मुझे ये क्या मुझे तुझे प्यार है, लेकिन मुझे उसके साथ ज़्यादा प्यार है. तो फिर मैं सोचूंगा तो फिर मैं क्या करूँगी, क्या मैं फिर मैं क्या रहूँ या बोलूँगा जाओ उसके साथ, नहीं तो मेरे पास हिम्मत नहीं है, तो फिर मैं हिम्मत कैसे चुकाऊँ. तो इसी शी स्टॉकिंग टू हर सेल्फ, मेरे शी बिकम्स हेमा मालिनी एंड मालिनी हेमा. समटाइम्स यू टॉक टू ईच अदर, इट्स कॉल्ड द सेल्फ टॉक. Most of the times told by the counselors to do self-talk, self-audit, self-watch, self-policing, self-direction, right? Self-analysis. So you can do self, the word is self. Self-policing. You can be your own police, but you police yourself. So what am I doing? What am I eating? What am I wearing? What am I saying? What am I hearing? Am I hurting somebody? Am I being kind? What am I doing? So that basically, even what I'm eating, how much am I eating?
Questioning.
Sorry?
Questioning yourself.
Questioning yourself. Question yourself. Ask yourself. So being self-watch, it's part of self. It comes by training. But it begins and it never leaves you. You start self-watch, it never leaves you. It grows, grows and grows. Yesterday I was in a meditation program in Bombay. They're called the Vipassana meditation. They celebrated 50 years of that. And one quotation I shared with them of Lord Buddha. Somebody went to Lord Buddha and said, "You've been meditating. What have you gained?" Buddha said, "Nothing. Not gained anything. But why don't you ask me what have I lost?" He said, "Okay, what have you lost?" He said, "Well, I lost my anger, depression, anxiety, fear, insecurity. Right? See, I lost my negative thoughts." So when you lose your negative thoughts, what do you gain? You are leaving space in your mind for positive thoughts. You're creating a space for it. Right? This is what can be done. Is by doing good, what have I gained? You have got inside you a feeling of a good sense of achievement. That's your gain. Not that I lost, I gave away. But what have I gained? I lost. No, you gained in the process. You lost money, but in the process you gained. Gained what? Something within you which gives you a sense of
Shanti.
Man ki shanti. Man ki shanti. Man ki shanti is a very big thing. Market se nahi milti man ki shanti. Unki man ki shanti dena. Can you go to a shop thing? Mujhe man ki shanti. Haan, goli hai. Goli hai. Ye habit has me. It will give you compost. Man ki shanti nahi. So jao. Ye lo. But when you get up, you need another compost.
Addiction
too. Or another addiction. Or a dependence. It creates a dependence. So these are, I think, the strategies of living. And you are all wonderful parents. Therefore, I'm focusing on more on that. That each one of us impacts wherever we are. We impact the home. We impact the neighborhood. We impact the society. We impact. Each one of us has an impact on our friends. We impact. The way we live, the way we conduct ourselves, it impacts. Like a good leader impacts. A corrupt leader pollutes. A good leader provides peace and harmony, right? So it's impact. It's the more powerful you are, the more ripples you create. A pebble creates little one. But throw a stone in and it creates havoc in the pond. Just throw a pebble, it has little. But throw a big half stone, it creates waves and effects God knows where of. So we all are those. We are sometimes pebbles and sometimes we are rocks in our life, in the ponds of our lives.
And what is the one thing you would like to achieve so much? What is the one thing which you feel that you can still achieve?
Meditate more.
Wow, that's it. So sweet.
Meditate more. But you see, another thing is, meditation is sometimes, it is eyes closed where you sink in. But meditation also with eyes open.
Yes.
When you work with your alertness and with unselfishness and with a sense of total giving, you are actually into a meditative work. So you can enlarge the definition of meditation. But I would certainly like to know myself more and also remain meditative and with eyes open.
Ma'am, can you tell us how you changed Bihar inmates in Bihar jail by yoga?
What happened in the prison was that when they came to the prison, they had no sense of timing. They did not know when is the day and the night. Some of them were drug addicts. They would drink through, sleep, keep awake at night. Like, for instance, my first day in the prison. I went the first night round in the prison and I found like owls, all kinds of sounds in the prison. All kinds of, there are 10,000. And I said, where are the sounds coming from? He said, madam, ye raat ko sote nahi ho. Why? Because aadhe se zyada to inko dard ho rahi hai, they goli khani hai. So they were addicted people. So they were not, and they were awake. And secondly, even if they were not addicts, they did nothing during the day. So they were not tired, so they could not get their sleep. So one of the first things I did in the prison was put them into a regime. Get up in the morning, go to school. Go to school. So even if it's a 16-year-old man, go to school. Because he was illiterate or semi-literate. So first thing I did was made it mandatory. Breakfast time 7:15, bathing, everything, food served. And by 9, you are in a classroom. So I divided the 10,000 people into illiterate, semi-literate, primary, secondary, etc., and higher. So every prisoner had a classroom to go to. Illiteracy, literacy, language classes, etc. Now the teachers became those people who were graduates above. So that was how discipline returned. 9 to 10, 11, discipline. So I used to walk my prison every day to see the classrooms are being held. Teachers, prisoners, prisoners became teachers. The graduates and above were all teachers. And the books came donated from all of you. People in Delhi, I appeal to the Delhi schools to send me used school books, copy books, pencils, and publishers. So I had so many bags to distribute to them according to the classrooms. So all of them had a bag, no money spent. So they had a bag, they had a teacher, they had a classroom. Sometimes the tree became a classroom. They were in the compounds accordingly. So 9 to 11, fixed. Now you have a break, you have your lunch. Then in the evening, some went for playing, some went for, then everybody went to play. But some also went into serving each other. They were all on the ball. Then came the discourses. I brought Brahma Kumaris very early. So Brahma Kumaris, the art of living, all of them came, even Osho came. So we used to have discourses in the prisons. Everybody sat and heard a spiritual parvachan every evening. And then they had Sangeet Mandalis. So you see, I kept them awake. I didn't let them sleep during the day. It's like their mother that so that he sleeps at night. I have to keep them awake through various means. And then they used to start. And then, of course, took away the drugs. We took away the drugs from the prison in a big way. Also medically treating them. So we disciplined them from morning till night. Educate, listen, live clean, contribute to each other, etc. And once it started to, what happened was that the new learning pushed away their negative learning. So it was like clash of thoughts. They're reading a book, they're learning, and now they're getting very nice. Oh, we are learning and reading and writing. It started to remove the negativity out because the whole atmosphere became spiritual. Evening discourse, yoga in the morning. I forgot to tell you. We started to do yoga in the morning. And then a lot of festival celebration. And then we gave them responsibility for a lot of activities. Then after about 6 to 8 months of good work, we found that now things have settled down. We started to, we brought in Vipassana meditation programs of different kinds. Jiske jo de sakta wo de. I noticed that was the dramatic shift. That was dramatic shift. Many, many prisoners after this kind of environment wanted to go back to court and confess. But what I did very smartly was that I isolated the gangsters from the main prison. All the gangsters of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh, those days we started to coyotes and gangsters from all these guys. We separated them, literally plucked them out of the barracks and put them into a high security ward, one to a person, one, so they don't pollute the other. And us one person ko bhi Gita di di, kitabe di di, par baith ke, par to pade, par baith ke. Then we had the counselors coming in. So we made them work with counselors one to one. Now they wanted to want to go home. Because they had jumped bail, they did not give bail to stay in the prison to continue crime and expand their program. But now when they realized that we can't expand crime and now we are only into jail and they are one to a person and we are waqai mein court bhi hai. Now they wanted to offer bail. But they were afraid to go out in Uttar Pradesh or Bihar. They were afraid of the encounter. And they were using my prison as a shelter. See, so now they had a choice. Sudhro, ya jao. Sudhro, ya maro. So I think that's where it started to help the new prisoners. This is what we did.
Very nice. So, being a mother today, I actually
Yes, yes.
From morning to night.
Correct. It was like mothering an institution.
Beautiful. Can you tell what kind of resistance you faced when you got in all these changes? Were they all very cooperative or how was it?
No, these gangsters only were the obstructors.
No, otherwise also the reforms what you brought about these changes.
Society welcomed it. Media loved it because it's the first time they were hearing. Because it was genuine, because 500 out of 10,000 prisoners, every day there's a new flow, new arrested people. There's also bailed out people, they got to go. So many, 500 went out, many came in, it was like a flow. These people who went out said, hame khana saaf mil raha, humko medical care mila, humko kitabe mili, humko parvachan mila, humko dhyan mila, humko sangeet mila, hum ye seekh kya, kisno ko computer sikhaye. So they started to spread the word. So we got a lot of goodwill and we got a lot of support. The only, as I told you, the challenge was gangsters. They would not. And also the challenge was the attitude of my staff. Because it had to become more honest. It cannot be exploited. But because I was doing my morning rounds on a regular basis, connecting with the information flow from prisoners came through a feedback box which I used to distribute. And I could letter, lots of letters from the prisoners to know what is happening inside. So the, now my staff was afraid that madam ko sab pata hai. Kyunki mujhe chitti ek box pe aati thi. It used to be like a letter box and a locked box. So people could post a letter and I used to open it on my table and every day I knew what was happening. And now my staff was afraid that she knows more than any one of us. And just by that feedback box, I introduced the system by which the system started to change. So therefore, the word of mouth got us goodwill. It started to spread the message that we were authentic, we were genuine, and challenge. The staff also changed a lot because their security also increased. Earlier, they were being beaten up by the staff. By the prisoners, they were beating up each other. When I took over, there was a beating happening. And I changed it only by separating the gangsters. Because it happened like, my staff came to me and said, madam, we want weapons. Please give us weapons because we are afraid. I said, what are you afraid of? Madam, ye jab baar aate na, humko dhamkiyan dete. They didn't have a compound wall. They didn't have security. So I got a compound wall made for them. I put a guard on them. But I didn't get the weapons. I said, no, we will change the culture of this prison. You will not beat anyone. But we separate the gangsters and correct them. Because if you beat them, then there's no difference between you and the street. So don't do this. You will not beat them, but we will correct them. So when we separated the gangsters, my staff was very relieved because they thought nobody could touch them. Because if I am getting them, they can threaten me. Then I now I'm only ready to go to them. Each one could be was a source of threat to me. But I was willing to take that threat. You asked me this question. I was willing to take that threat, but they did not threaten me for the reason my intention was good. They understood, and I think being a woman mattered. That's where my woman became a plus factor, is that my intention was not authoritative. It was not Hitlerian. It was Gandhi. It was persuasive. It was not ordering brutality. It was caring and yet very firm. So it was like a headmaster approach, where you reward and punish. But there was hardly any need for me, that was punishment itself, that they had all, okay? So this is what it is. So the threats were not from, it was from within, but staff changed, prisoners changed, and then came from, but media, everybody was very happy, because they were said, pehle to sari broad, black borderline milti thi, black borderline headline, ab to sari positive. It was not I who was saying it, these prisoners who were going, and some of them were foreigners. Foreigners, this message was going to foreign countries that in the Indian Tihar prison, this is what we are being looked up. I'll tell you a story. Once I went in the morning and I found a group of foreign prisoners were just crying and sulking around. And I said, what's the matter? He said, ma'am, it's his birthday today. And he said, oh, happy birthday to you. So the moment I said, happy birthday, what can I get you? What does he like? I asked his friends. He said, ma'am, he loves the guitar. He loves playing the guitar. I said, okay, should I get you a guitar? Should I get you? And by the way, he got a guitar. He got a guitar. And he played on the guitar. See, point here is, these are little things that matter. So we, for me, getting a guitar was no problem. But getting him a guitar changed the whole scene of modern Christmas. So they started, then after that, many functions we had, he used to play the guitar. Sorry?
I said after listening to your talk, the sleeping potential in everyone will be awakened.
We all have so much within to give, so much to know, and each one of us is so talented within. We just have to invoke our own talents. Somebody's very good at singing, go learn singing. Somebody's an instrument, go learn singing. Somebody's very good reader, read more. Somebody's a writer, write more, write. Just do. Enjoy. Somebody's good at playing, go. Somebody's at embroidery, share. Somebody's excellent at cooking, cook for the other. Teach each other. Share. Invoke your own potential and share.
Share. That's and share. Get their potential when they are young.
When yeah, and of course, when they're I'm at the moment on your potential. Yes. While the junior potential, certainly, but at your potential, you have so much. Some of you can. So go learn. It's never late to learn anything new or refresh it.
It's within you.
Search it. What is within you? Let's hear the two pillars.
This is the new challenge of bringing up children to this media, this internet and all that. Yes. How is that to be faced? Because you find it very difficult. You spoke about television, but now it's gone much beyond it. So it's very challenging.
Very close time with them. You have to continue to talk, communicate with them.
Yeah, but they don't seem to be.
Let them argue with you. But keep communicating and steering. Keep listening to them. But if you don't, then they've deformed their own views and friends have influenced them. So, but you remember you are role models too.
Yeah, of course, yes, I know. I
mean, so we are role models ourselves also. So if we are very busy all the time on social media while they are with you, then they'll also be busy.
They learn what they
learn. They learn. So catch them young. But at that time, be very sensitive to what they're seeing. And then don't uselessly watch any television like that. You don't need it, don't need it. Why keep the noise on? Switch it off and be home. So you will have to balance it, and then they'll understand that this is of selective value, not all universal value. Yes, sir. Yours.
We are so inspired and
so happy that we are really
getting
your simplicity and humbleness really makes us
determination.
Sorry, what did you say?
Having lived in all your
having lived in the north. Oh, I've done a tour tenure in Mizoram also. I've done a very good 3-year tenure in Mizoram. I worked with the Mizo population in a big way. All nice human beings. I think basically human beings are nice the way you deal with them.
Because you are good man yourself. You are nice yourself. So you find everybody nice.
Yes, you begin with that.
No, but there is as a media, when you read, there is a lot of tussle between the left and governor and the political class. How is that?
That will always exist. Because their needs are different. Their needs is power to stay in power. My need is apply the law and the rules. And there's bound to be a conflict. It cannot be resolved unless one gives in. Unless I give in to them for their short-term, long-term needs, which are how do I do everything by which I get something back. Their whole life as politicians is very good exceptions exist in this country who've been transformational. But if you have to guess power, then politicians have to do things mostly with the eye on the vote bank. Because in the end, it is what brings you back is your vote. Isn't it? Votes count. So their needs are different, right or wrong. But my need is not the vote. My need is the law and the rules. Now, if they want to keep giving, giving, I have to see whether there's money in the budget. And if there's no money in the budget, who will tell them? You will say, sorry, no money. And they say, she doesn't give us money. And they but don't tell her, tell them we don't have money. They announce money when I tell them there's no money. Or there is money. Yes, there is money. But the money must go by direct transfer. Why are you distributing money? When everybody's an Aadhaar account, why don't you let it go direct transfer? They want money this way. I said, no, not this way. Button, transfer. So see, there's a conflict. Mine is, let the money go directly without any loss of transmission in the transmission. There is, what do I gain unless I say, I'm giving you the money. So you see, the needs are in conflict. And this conflict will always remain. It's never gone. You have to live and work through this conflict. That's what I'm doing.
How can the woman protect herself?
In
so many crimes against
time, why is it? I think stay alert. It's being very alert. You have to stay alert. Alertness is important. It's not to be where you need not be. And get the early signs of violence and stop it at early stage. It's your own alertness. Yet there can be 5% chance where you caught unaware. But leave it to 5%. 95% is preventable. Therefore, stay alert, stay fit, stay agile. That's the main thing. Be alert, be watchful. Okay? This is Chennai Sindhi Ladies Chapter. See, they've come with so many books, etc., etc., to be given to our Asha, who will then distribute it to school children.
It's a very, very nice thing to do, because when we were told that memento and shawl is not needed, so this is better to give for the children.
Hey, good. That's a good one. So the shawls and mementos were replaced and brought us books.
And we asked Asha, and she gave us the right advice. I'm very thankful to you, Asha.
That's it. That's
she's
what
a lovely
want.
Person.
Yes, she is the cause of all this change. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes, yes.
You are the leader.
Yes.
Yes.
The leader. You are the leader, ma'am.
Yes. I am because of her. The team, the kind of team, the kind of energy she gives us.
Ma'am, you're an open book.
My time is always there, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Thank you.
Are you deliberately being one of you?
Yes.
Thank you. All over your cheeks too.
I've seen you. We've become really much of a
love you, ma'am.
Seen you after years on the tennis court.
Yes,
Your blessings are here.
One of the most down-to-earth people we've come across. I never expected this.